bring it.
On your mark, ready, set, let's go. Dance floor bro, I know, you know. I go psycho when my new joint hit. Just can't sit, gotta get jiggy with it. That's it, now honey, honey, come ride. TKNY, all up in my eye. You got a rider, bag with a lot of stuff in it. Give it to your friend, let's spin. Everybody looking at me, glancing a kid. Wishing they was dancing a jig here with this handsome kid. Sick a cigar right from Cuba Cuba. I just bite it, it's for the look, I don't light it. Ill way to hand, they on the hand, stay off play. Give it up, jiggy, make it feel like foreplay.
Welcome back to This Week in Lacrosse. And Ron, some great pitchers to start us off again this week.
Yep, you know, I want to draw focus Gary away just from the just the NLL thing just for a minute. All those emblems you just saw, all the home teams that just flashed up there, you guys, you're the fans that pay the money to go to these games, whether it's the major series or junior A or the Rock games, and you were all members of, I think, the biggest group of knowledgeable lacrosse fans anywhere, because this is the heartland of the game, the Golden Horseshoe. So anyways, I'm just reaching out to you people. We don't forget you. This isn't just all about the NLL. This is about all lacrosse, all over Ontario.
I have to give you my picture one day. Maybe, you know what? Okay. Let's get that old picture of you with your foot in the crease down at the Q Beach. And we'll put that up one day.
Sure. And the last one there was a guy named Fripp Harrison from the 1932 Mimico Mountaineers. They were the Man Cup champions that year. And I got that information courtesy of Powers Bible of Lacrosse.
Fripp.
Our buddy the Whomper.
Fripp.
Fripp Harrison.
Why don't we have any more Fripps in the game today?
Well, we got rid of all the nicknames in the Rock, so this is, you know, yeah. they had them way back in the day as well.
All right, so the week in the NLL, oh my gosh, is that the best way to say it? Or obviously, huge going on in Toronto. Mm-hmm. You're still undefeated, by the way. Congratulations.
Thank you.
But we'll get to that in a few minutes. But I mean, it kind of ties in. Let's just quickly review some of the results, and we'll have a little bit of conversation about each game. Calgary was into Minnesota. Last week, we both picked Calgary to continue their winning ways. Mm-hmm. And of course, good on you, the Swarm and their fans. They
excellent.
Their first win of the year.
Excellent, excellent win. That means a lot in that area, too, because that's another real hotbed of lacrosse, too, is the Minneapolis, St. Paul area. And I understand they grew a great crowd. And everybody's on the boards there cutting up their sweaters and stuff. Those stripy sweaters remind me of the ones that are in the picture, like that Fripp Harrison had on their old style sweaters. Yeah. So maybe they're, you know, that's what they're trying to do, a throwback thing. But anyways, great effort by them to beat last year's champs.
Yeah, and I, you know what, I kind of like the shirt. I didn't think they were that bad. So.
Yeah. And Zach Greer showed up, a couple of goals and some assists.
Yeah, you know it's going to be an adjustment for him. And great kid, great lacrosse player, and he's going to be fine. Just good to see them get their first win. Calgary 1-1 on the road. I mean, and it's the same in every professional league. Any team going on the road is not a given anymore.
No.
And you know, that hometown amount of fans behind you, that home team's always got a little bit of an advantage. So it is pretty tough to win on the road here. The other game, Edmonton and Washington. You had this one right. You picked Washington. I thought Edmonton was going to sweep the weekend, and boy, oh boy, 15-7. Mm-hmm. Washington not looking like they're missing Colin Doyle at this point just yet.
No, you know, I think the stealth are for real. The reason that they're not in a lot of people's minds is they're, you know, the furthest team away from, you know, this area, and we don't hear a lot about them because it's a small fan base and they don't have a big national coverage or whatever. But that team is just one guy short from last year, and they've added some good bodies. You know, nothing that, you know, Colin Doyle is a great player, but he, you know, one guy is not a team. And there's still some great guys with the stuff.
And in that trade, don't forget, they did get Lewis Ratcliffe. And
yes.
Lewis Ratcliffe has hit the ground running in Washington.
Yes.
Offensively, anyway, he's picking up what they're missing from Doyle being in Toronto now. So, again, a team to kind of watch there. I wasn't quite sure how that the effect would how it would affect Washington, them losing Doyle, but so far in the season anyway, only two games in, doesn't look like it's affected them at all. I'm going to skip over the Boston-Toronto game. We're going to get into that. Edmonton the next night, though, did they go into Colorado? Was that in Colorado?
Yes.
Edmonton in Colorado. They win in Colorado. Close game. And the result of that game, actually one point, just I'll get you to comment on both of these. Mm-hmm. Bob McMahon, unfortunately, losing his head coaching position. I'm not sure quite how quickly after the game. But big story, I'm sure, Gavin Prout going back against his former team. I don't believe there was any sort of ill will with that trade that saw Gavin leave Colorado, but when you go in against your former team in any situation, you got to be a little bit pumped up. 7 assists in that game.
Yeah, classy move by the Mammoth organization too in that game. They played a video clip montage of his
accomplishments
yeah. while he was there, and 17,000 something plus to lead the way again in attendance in the first week in the NLL, the second week in the NLL, pardon me. And yeah, way to go, Gavin. And to unfortunately cost Bobby his job. You know?
Yeah. And I'll say, I mean, if you ever watch Gavin play, the guy, he knows how to play one way, mm-hmm. go and play hard. So I'm sure the Mammoth fans, they're missing him, but they also appreciate what he did. One last game there, Rochester at Buffalo. The Bandits are now 0-2. Mm-hmm. The Nighthawks are 2-0 coming into Toronto this weekend, playing the 2-0 Rock. What do you see there? I called that one. You had the Bandits in that one. Surprised by that or yeah. surprised by Bandits?
Well, the only thing I didn't factor into my thought patterns was that John Tavares wasn't in the game.
Right.
And that in itself would be a big adjustment.
It's a couple goals,
you know,
at least.
And, you know, I didn't expect it. I did not expect that. But obviously, Rochester is for real. Yeah. The bit that I watched, John Grant looks good. Mr. Gate looks good. They were missing Sean Evans last week. He was suspended for the game for something he did in the first week. So I'm looking for one heck of a game. I'm going to comment on this a little bit after as well.
Well, and I was just going to say, I didn't realize that John Tavares was out of the game, but one of the things that I based my pick on was I knew John Grant was in the game. So we'll leave it at that. So the goings-on at the ACC, mm-hmm. if you missed the first 5 minutes of the game, it had a total lead. It just threw you a 180. Four guys getting tossed from each team,
yep.
4 minutes, 4.5 minutes into the first quarter. Let's talk about it.
I didn't expect it to go that way. I expected to see some pugilism, put it nicely, along the way. But to say who started and who didn't, I think they both, the Rock weren't going to let anybody walk into the building, i.e., Troy Cordonley and Terry Sanderson were not going to let anybody walk into that building with a big TV audience at home and a lot of people's eyes on this production and the whole bit to not stand up and show everybody that they're serious and they're back.
And a comment that I want to throw out, just Paul Dawson, Colin Doyle, summertime teammates, I don't know if they're, I'm assuming they're buddies, they're teammates. Mm-hmm. A lot of fan forum comments and a lot of comments about Dawson, you know, going after Doyle. And, you know, and I like both guys, both good guys, both great for the game. Paul Dawson just has a ton of fun out on the floor, the mm-hmm. logs flowing. Colin Doyle, one of the all-time greats in the game. I got to say, I think it was two guys that lost their temper.
Yes.
Dawson definitely did not go after Doyle.
No.
Doyle came in and cross-checked Dawson, frustrated, no problem. Dawson went back at him, cross-checked him again. I don't know, was it a dive? Did he knock him to the ground? Whatever. Doyle, to his credit, got back up and thought, not in my house, you're going to do that. Mm-hmm. Now, at that point, I'm thinking, look at those two great Canadian boys going at it. Teammates in the summer, you're not on my team right now. You know what? Things got out of hand. Next thing you know, they're coming to blows.
Yeah.
To me, you know, it's the tough guy for Boston fighting the star for Toronto. My first reaction sitting up with you is, how is Toronto letting this happen? Good God.
Yeah.
But after I looked at it a bit, I think it was Colin Doyle. Colin Doyle, to his credit, was standing up to the tough guy and thought, you know what, I'm going to get our fans and I'm going to get my team into it.
Yeah.
And from there, as you say, all hell broke loose.
Yeah, you know, that was the feeling around us behind the scenes that, you know, we had to make a statement, and be it the show on the TV or the guys on the floor or something, to let everybody know that we're back. And that was a feeling that was right through the dressing room, the whole bit. I can tell you that right now. And that felt good.